Penguin Random House presents Invisible Empire, The Natural History of Viruses by Pranay Lal, read by Mishal Varma. Please refer to the supplement PDF to view diagrams and additional information provided for each chapter. Acknowledgements. It was sometime in January 2020 that the news of a mysterious fever in China began to trickle in. By early February, it became a topic of intense discussion with my office chai mates, Drs. Anand Das, Amit Sahu, and B.M. Prasad. Very soon it became obvious that our predictions, like everyone else's at the time, were horribly off the mark. As the virus spread across continents, leaving scores of dead in its wake, what also became obvious was the deep animosity towards viruses, or really anything microbial, especially among my public health colleagues. While I understood that their hostility was justified, I also knew that the virus-human story is not so black and white. Since my graduate student days, I have understood that microbial communities are like human societies. Ecological conditions can keep them at peace or turn them against one another or against other organisms. However, no amount of my convincing them about how essential microbes as a whole are or how viruses can be beneficial could persuade my otherwise scientific and rational colleagues. Trying to reason with friends and family too drew ire and castigation. How could I be so insensitive, they asked. In early April 2020, when Namita Gokhale and Sanjoy Roy asked me to give a talk for the Jaipur Literature Festival on the pandemic, I hesitated. I had very little to add beyond what scientists all over the world were discussing. Instead, I offered to speak about the benefits of viruses. Namita and Sanjoy were surprised but agreed. Pratik Kanjilal, my wonderful interlocutor, helped me set the tone and allowed me to approach the topic with sensitivity. A few weeks later, Pavan Srinath asked me to do a podcast for the Bangalore International Center, and other talks followed. I realized that the story, which was so clear to me, was not as obvious to others. I went back to my copious notes and pieced together a narrative about the natural history of viruses. This book is a result of that. I have little to offer to those looking for racy accounts of exotic killer viruses emerging from steamy tropical jungles or gory details of past epidemics that changed the course of history. However, those who are curious to know about elements of natural history from the perspective of the microbe kind, this book is for you. I will feel redeemed if I can at least half convince the reader of the vital contributions that viruses and microbes make to our lives. I have chosen 11 stories from the colorful world of viruses that I found interesting. There are many others that could have easily and rightfully found a place here, and I hope there will be other writers who will find ways to tell those stories in more interesting ways. This book would not have happened without my wife Vandana Singh Lal, who gave generous advice on every draft. These comments shaped my early text in more ways than I can tell. As I was struggling to put forth my contrarian views, she helped me find a logical thread for the disparate stories. In these difficult times, she juggled between the various demands of work and family, and she put her writing plans on hold for some time to focus on reading and correcting my umpteen drafts. Thank you, V. Muito obrigado, Pradeep Krishan, for being such an important part of my life, for being excited about my ideas, for hearing my long-winded stories patiently, and for reading every terrible draft I sent. The book is so much better for the insights you have provided. And my children, Arya and Avi, Angel and Chirab, often imps and sometimes devils, for continuing to be patient with and even excited about my incessant conversations about viruses while we have been stuck together in unprecedented ways in this rather extraordinary year. Thank you, Avi, for giving insightful comments. This past year, I badgered scientists and experts with telephone calls and requests for online interviews. I sought their advice to see if I was correct in my interpretation as I navigated through a vast maze of scientific literature. I thank Jeremy Barr, Paul Heyman, Tanvi Honap, Nigel Hughes, Rupender Kaur, Rick McLaughlin, Rituban Ray Chaudhary, Vinay Sachdeva, and Lee Young for reading my early drafts and providing useful comments. Elliot J. Lefkowitz of the International Committee on Taxonomy of Viruses has generously permitted me to use images from the ICTV database. Sincere thanks to all the illustrators, artists, and photographers who have shared their works gratis. My deep gratitude to Meeta Kapoor and the team at Siyahi for supporting my ideas to the hilt, and Meru Gokhale, the consummate author's editor. If only other writers were as lucky. Ahlavat Gunjan did his usual magic with the elegant cover and design. Aparna Kumar stayed vigilant to spot any gaffes that could have crept in while dealing with multiple drafts. Mihir Joglekar, Neeraj Nath at Penguin Random House, and my daughter Arya Lal drew elegant illustrations which have made the book lively. It is tempting, after having benefited from the help of such generous contributions of thoughts, ideas, and editorial advice from experts and friends, to blame the remaining blunders and boo-boos in this book on them. In the interest of honesty, I must resist that temptation. Any mistakes and misinterpretations that may have inadvertently crept in are solely mine. Chapter 1. Bounty. Let's get this out of the way first. What exactly is a microbe? Quite simply, any life form that can only be seen under a powerful lens or microscope. And how many microbes exist in the world? If you were to say a trillion to the power of trillion, chances are you will still be well short of the actual number, which is likely to be inestimable, perhaps even unimaginable. Consider this: the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, short for coronavirus disease 2019, started out as a tiny speck in the airway of a wild animal before it passed through hundreds of millions of human lungs, trailing havoc in its path. At the time of writing this, there have been nearly 122 million recorded cases of COVID-19 in the world. A British mathematician has, however, estimated that all of the world's circulating SARS-CoV-2, short for Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus 2, the causative agent of COVID-19 virus, could easily fit inside the confines of a single can of cola. From what we know, only an infinitesimally small fraction of microbes make us sick. Even fewer have the power to kill us. Most simply pass through us, and a few use us as a suitable substrate to make more of their kind. They usually don't bother us in the least, and some, in fact, many actually do us good. In every pinch of undisturbed soil, in every drop of water, there live a billion bacteria and 10 times that number of viruses. Every lungful of breath we take contains about 1,000 microbes. Most of them are unknown to us. Into this mysterious universe of microbes come the scientists diving deep, like Captain Nemo, stooped over modern microscopes. They sit gazing at a wondrous world to explore the lives of the predators and prey, producers and parasites. Some of the microbes are solitary, a few are in conjugal bliss, or are colonizers. Many are barely minutes old. The rest are mature, dying, or already dead. Each speck of life you see under a microscope has a well-defined role, and in their plurality, they make up habits no less complex than that of a multi-storied tropical forest. The crucial difference is that life, in the microbial world, plays out several times faster. Microbes come in tantalizing forms and often in geometry-defined shapes. They can be translucent or iridescent, twitching or fleeting as one watches them. A plethora of awesome diversity in just a thimbleful of pond water or in soil taken from under leaf litter. There is no singular world of microbes. Every ecosystem has its own set of curious microbial communities, from the freezing ice of Antarctica to the hot sands of the Sahara, in the placid pond in your neighborhood to deep-sea volcanic vents. They are everywhere. The surface of a pond teems with numerous photosynthetic organisms. Delve just a foot deeper and the character of organisms changes, while the benthic bottom of the pond and its sediments may have nothing in common with what is on top. A change of seasons or even the time of day can alter the proportions and number of microbes present. Microbial diversity shifts across the surface of the Earth as a consequence of the same three forces that Charles Darwin highlighted to explain the diversity of plants and animals: environment, dispersal, and diversification. Microbes mirror the same geographic patterns of diversity as those found in larger organisms, with the variety of microbes or bacterial species richness twice as large in the warmer tropics than it is at the frigid poles. Microbes come in bewildering shapes and are deeply complex, and in terms of sheer numbers are unmatched by any other life form. Try this for size. It is estimated that there are 100 million times as many bacteria in the oceans, 1.3 into 10 to the power of 29, as there are stars in the known universe. There are more microbes in natural water than in the soil around it, or in the air above. Even on dry land, their numbers are immense and surpass the imagination. The average number of microbes in a single teaspoon of soil, 10 to the power of 9, is as large as the human population of Africa. The human jowl alone, on average, has more than 6 billion microbes that can be made up of more than 600 separate species. A single gram of the stale-smelling, yellow, grimy film on our teeth, good old plaque, has approximately 10 to the power of 11 bacteria, which is about the same number as that of all the humans that have ever lived. Communities of microbes are so deeply interdependent that every species relies on one or more of another kind for its survival. The microbial world is organized like a town fair. Under the microscope, you will see in a drop of pond water or diluted tropical soil a network of thread-like fungi that run like the tracks of roller coasters and toy trains. Next to them, you will see a huddle of amoebae, and close by, congregations of different bacteria, each minding their own business, but all in some way cooperating to exploit a particular environment. Pale green photosynthetic creatures of various shapes and sizes compete for light. Some jostle and trade for minerals they seek. A few may fancy their chances to mate or are in the act of gobbling up another, while others are in active pursuit, and some still want to be the first to scavenge on the dying and the dead. The effect of this interdependence is deeply significant, as it sets the tone of relationships for all life on Earth. The interdependence of microbes with all life that we see around us began in deep time, long before we were even a speck on nature's timeline, as it were. The earliest ancestors of modern...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.